So welcome to this session about open data and models for mapping ecosystem services. My name is Pedro Cabral. I come from Universidade Nova de Lisboa. I'm with Nova Information Management School. Okay. I'm here a professor in GIS, Geographic Information Systems. Okay. So I will try to make this an interesting session. It will also include hands-on with the software. So if you have a computer with you, of course you have, otherwise we'll not be assisting to this session. But you need to have installation authorizations in your computer so you can install the software. So my presentation for this workshop is about trying to show you why is it important to study ecosystem services. I will put forward some research questions. I will show some methods for working with open data and open models to calculate ecosystem services indicators. Then I will show you some results, not just our results, research results, but also results from other researchers. Okay, so then I'll make some conclusions, and then to relax, I will do some hands-on with Invest, which is a software developed by University of Stanford that enables you to calculate ecosystem services indicators. So I would like to thank the conference for allowing me to come here to present this workshop with some hands-on. It's really a pleasure to be here at Jornadas Ibéricas de Infraestruturas Dados Espaciais. Okay? So, motivation for working with ecosystem services. I know this is an online presentation, so I cannot see who is behind the camera. But I'd like to explain to you why it's important to work with this concept and to show you also that geographical data and geographic information systems play a very important role in this matter because it can really provide you with important information. So I always start this presentation with this question, show you the motivation. So why would you work with ecosystem services? And the answer is very simple. It involves a lot of money. Of course, this is a practical joke, but it's true. If we start collecting data and information about ecosystem services and the value and try to associate an economic value to those services, we'll come up to a very, very big number. Okay? So there are studies about this. I think the most important one was published in 1997 in Nature Journal. So he, Robert Costanza, and hundreds dozens of authors with him, he calculated this value for a year, okay, for the whole world, okay. And now there is an ongoing trend of trying to, for all the countries, do this kind of studies to see how much the ecosystem services in those countries are worth, okay. So the GIS, because this is related to location. They provide very important information about ecosystem services, not just to mapping them, but also to calculate them using geographical data. Okay? So, and my mission here for today's session is to show you that we can actually use GIS with some open models and also open data to come up with some results already. Okay? So this is a very powerful and intuitive concept. So basically, we want to quantify the level of production and associate that production to a geographical area to know where are those ecosystem services. Okay, so this can be recreation services, can be pollination services, can be agriculture for food. So it can be landscape quality. So there are many, many different ways of quantifying and looking to ecosystem services. So I would say this is a very hot topic in the research agenda, and I hope to convince you with that today. Okay, so here we have the study of the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment. So basically, they group the ecosystem services, which are the benefits added by nature to men. Okay, so, and basically what this report does, it divides all ecosystem services into four different categories. Okay, so this can be supporting services, provisioning services, regulating services, and control services. And all them have a direct impact on well-being. Okay, so this is completely human-centering. Okay, so if we reduce or eliminate any of these ecosystem services, then we'll have an impact, a negative impact on human well-being. Okay, so this is the basic idea behind this concept. Okay, so it's very interesting to find ways of identifying, quantifying, and mapping ecosystem services. Okay, so we can see also how, if we change management, what will be the impact on ecosystem services. For instance, if I change, if land cover changes, what will be the impact in terms of quantity in ecosystem services, but also in terms of economic, okay? So here in this session, I'll try to show you how can we use GIS to study ecosystem services. Of course, the idea of doing this kind of studies is that one day they are part of planning and they are included in planning. So, and our mission here, me as a researcher, is try to provide quantitative indicators so that people and managers can actually use those that information for managing and planning landscape. Okay, so I will also show you what we are doing to make ecosystem services data available. Okay, we are working on a project, a research project, and I will show you how we are developing a tool for disseminating, making the data available to anybody with no costs. Okay, so ecosystem services are everywhere. I would say it like this. Of course, now also, there is also very important interest in urban areas because it's where most of people are, and we are all worried about making cities more and more sustainable and more livable, so they are nice places to be. Okay, so it's also a way of defending and showing how can we improve ecosystem services in urban areas, so life quality in urban areas also improves. Okay, so this is a very diversified area. Okay, I have put here a table which is very, very incomplete. The table is divided in those four groups of ecosystem services I mentioned before: provisioning, regulating, cultural services, habitat for biodiversity. On the left, you have the name of the ecosystem services. There are many. I don't have here a comprehensive list, but it's a quite important number. And on the right, there are possible ecosystem services indicators that we can use as a proxy or as an indicator for measuring that ecosystem services. So, as you can see, it's a very, very rich area, okay? So if you try to read some of those indicators there, they all call for different techniques and knowledge, so we can actually calculate those ecosystem services. So I would say that if you want to work in this area, you will never get bored because you really have many, many options and many, many types of knowledge that you need to be aware of if you want to provide indicators of ecosystem services, okay? So then what's been done also recently, more recently, it's besides calculating the biophysical quantities of the ecosystem services, there are also people, typically economics, people from economy and ecology, ecologists, economists, so something like that. So they try to put a dollar value to the services that are provided. Okay. If you look into the literature, there are many studies. I've put here some of those studies in which the researchers try to quantify the economic value of the ecosystem service. Okay. So there are many, many papers. I have to update these tables. It's getting old. But there are many studies about the valuation, economic valuation of the ecosystem service. And actually, the software that I'm going to show you in the end of the session also provides you with the ability of calculating some economic value for ecosystem services. So in terms of methodology, there are different software available to work with ecosystem services. Probably I've heard about some of these. For instance, Invest models. These are the models that I'm working on mostly. It's called Invest, Integrated Valuation of Environmental Services and Trade-offs. It's a model developed by a research group in the University of Stanford. And there are hundreds of papers published with the software. Okay. Then there are also more models. Actually, you can also find some software, like for instance, Terraset. It's now the old Idrisi. Probably some of you have worked with it. So Terraset also implements some ecosystem services calculations from land cover. Okay. So we can find more and more tools to work with this concept. These are just some of them. One of the most popular ones, I would say, it's Invest models. Okay. Okay. Where can I find data to work with Invest? I'm going to focus my presentation now on Invest because all the work I'll be presenting to you is calculated with Invest and also based on land cover. So Invest works mostly, most of the models they have there are based on land cover maps. Okay. So it's very important to have land cover maps and more data as the one I'm going to show you here that then you can use as an input to calculate those ecosystem services. Some open data sets for working with Invest can be, for instance, OpenStreetMap, okay? For instance, to work with the biodiversity model, you can input some roads or location of urban areas as stressors for biodiversity, okay? So it's also interesting and important to work with land cover data. And there is many data sets available about land cover data, like foreign land cover or national land cover maps. For instance, for Portugal, we have the CAO. Okay. We can also use, depending on the model, actually, Invest is a suite of models. So they have like 15 or 16 different models. Each one corresponds to an ecosystem service. So and the idea is that according to the model we use, then we'll get the data we need. Okay. So, but I'm just listing here some of the common data sets if you want to work with Invest. Okay, so you also need to have climatic data, okay? Precipitation, it's a common data set to use in hydrological models that Invest also has. Digital elevation models, for instance, to work with erosion models. So these links that I put here, they all have open data. Okay, you can actually download these data sets for free. And of course, if you are working at different scales, you will probably need to find other data sources. Okay. For instance, digital elevation model. Yeah, sorry, I put here land cover maps. This digital elevation model also. I forgot to put here the title land cover maps. So digital elevation models, you have a data set for Europe. You also probably have for your countries. digital version models for free, or you can get digital version models, for instance, in Earth Explorer. Okay, you can get Aster data or SRTM data for free. Okay, then you also need to have maybe, depending on the type of model you are going to use, soil data. You can take a look, for instance, at European Union repository of environmental data. Okay, so it's, you can get some information there. Remote sensing, you can also get data from, depending on the satellites you are interested, but you can get Sentinel data or Landsat data for free. You can get biodiversity data from GBI, for instance. And more recently, I also been reading some studies, very interesting studies, in which you use not only remote sensing, but social media location information, location-based information for studying ecosystem services. For instance, there is this study for Sierra Nevada. Okay? There are other studies, but I just found this one today. Actually, I already had learned about this study before, but I put this in this presentation. Okay, there are other applications of social media for measuring ecosystem services. Then you need to search for them. Those systems like Scopus or Web of Science. Okay, so we have tools, open tools. We have data, open data, and what kind of results we can get with these types of models. Okay, of course you can take a look at academic publications to see how researchers have been applying this type of models to calculate ecosystem service. This is a, I would say, mandatory type of work because this is still a very new area in terms of how to create new indicators of ecosystem services. So it's always good to take a look at publications to see how researchers are trying to create indicators to see if they can come up with some ideas or some alternatives if you don't have exactly the data you need. Okay, you can also see papers in which there is this very interesting ecosystem service evaluation database. Basically, this is a database of studies in which economic valuation is used. Okay, so if you are interested in monetary evaluation, I would say this would be a very important place for you to start with. Okay, of course, this. You should also take a look at Scopus and Web of Science because there are many, many papers coming out every day. Some of them with very interesting original results about how to calculate ecosystem services. Okay. So then sometimes it's also possible, not so common, to find WebGIS or websites with special data sets specifically about ecosystem services for some regions. Okay, for instance, when I was preparing this presentation, I found this website for the Southeast USA, okay, where you can download for free some ecosystem services mapping data sets. This is very interesting, not so common, okay. But it's something that really is important, not just for researchers, but for planners, in case you want to create new spatial planning instruments and things like that. If you want to consider sustainability aspects in those plans, you really need to know where ecosystem services are, okay? Actually, I also found some shapefiles and attributes in European Union JRC data repository. Okay, so I think then if you want, I can make this presentation available. I have my email in the end and in the beginning. I don't know if you have access to this presentation immediately, but if you then are interested, just send me an email and I will answer. Okay. You can also find some scientific publications. There are specific journals about publishing a data set. And I also found this data set of ecosystem services for Beijing and its surrounding areas. So basically, you have access to the data that was created by the study. This is interesting, okay? So there are many, many types of output for ecosystem service studies. It really depends on the ecosystem services you are analyzing, okay? And they can be very different. So remember those four groups of ecosystem services, then each group has dozens of different types of ecosystem services. For instance, we did a study for Mozambique. We calculated the exposure index to catastrophes of the coast of Mozambique, which is about 2,700 kilometers. It's a very long coastal area. And we calculated the importance of natural habitats in preventing those catastrophes. Okay, so we could come up with some values, okay, to see how important are natural habitats for saving lives in Mozambique that are related to catastrophes. Okay, so we published this study. This study, it's interesting because we didn't just create a map. Okay, we also validated the map with real events, historical events in Mozambique. And we come up with a result which matched very well with historical events in the country. Okay, so but here the ecosystem services we are analyzing, it's the importance of natural habitats in the coast and their role in protecting the coast from this kind of catastrophes. Okay, another study we did for Mozambique, we tried to quantify the monetary values of ecosystem services in Mozambique from land cover, okay? And we calculated the changes between 2005 and 2009, okay? So basically what we did, we used land cover data from European Special Space Agency, okay? They have this data for Africa and for these two dates. And then we used economic quantification of the types of land cover for Mozambique. So we come up with these values and we used a lot of literature review, also the ecosystem service valuation database to quantify economically the value of the services in Mozambique, okay? Okay, so we calculated this for specific services, okay, using INVEST. Okay, we calculated the value of water yield, water quality, erosion regulation, biodiversity, climate regulation, and we also calculated the changes over time. In this case, using the INVEST model. So these indicators here are all obtained from INVEST models, okay? We also did a study for Bordeaux in France, okay? We assessed the impact of land cover changes on ecosystem services. The impact of land cover changes is very interesting to study because we can create management scenarios, okay? So when we create a plan, a landscape plan, we can establish the type of decisions that will definitely have an impact on land cover. So we can, we have information about the impact of those decisions, we can see which decisions are more sustainable, okay? So this is a foreign land cover map for Bordeaux, okay? So we had all these classes. And this was a study that involved stakeholders, okay? The idea of these approaches is not to do the studies on your offices, like we sometimes tend to do in university. The idea is to involve all the people involved in that have some interest in the consequences of land cover changes, and also we want to know about their opinion to see what type of ecosystems and services they value the most. Okay, so this was a stakeholder two-phase project. Okay, and then in the end, we calculated these ecosystem services using these ecosystem services indicators with Invest. So we come up with this kind of information. So we could see which ecosystem services were being degraded over time, okay, since the 90s. These are the dates of falling land cover for that time study. And we could actually provide them with a dashboard of maps saying where some ecosystem services are being degraded the most, or where some of them are being improved, or some are persistent. Okay, so we can actually use these monitoring tools to understand where the problems are. So, and we can do this with GIS, open data, and open models. Okay, then we also calculated some indicators according to economic scenarios. Okay, with land cover scenarios. We also did this for Bordeaux. We did some calculations in million euros. So this study was done with economists, which I'm not, okay? And we could calculate the value, economic value of each scenario according to each ecosystem service, okay? So we also created this kind of maps. The columns are the scenarios. The lines are the ecosystem services. We could see the progression, the information for each kind of scenario. Okay, so to conclude the results presentation, because I also want to show you the how to use Invest. So there is this project called Assessment of Ecosystem Services, Biodiversity and Well-being in Portugal. This is a project funded by the Portuguese Science Foundation. It already resulted in many publications, and you can see, if you have any questions, you can ask me. But the idea was, we use land cover, in this case, falling land cover. We created a temporal series of ecosystem services for Portugal. We selected those ecosystem services with the help of stakeholders. And we are also working in scenarios, the economic evaluation, okay? So we are now in the phase of finishing the project. We are completing the WebGIS. We are going to deliver all the data about ecosystem services produced within the project for free to the users. Unfortunately, the WebGIS is still not ready for this presentation here, but it will be hopefully until the end of the year, maybe 2 weeks or four more, but somewhere between the end of the year and January, the WebGIS will be ready, okay? So the WebGIS, it's based on Esri platform, so these are already some real views of the WebGIS. We are providing ecosystem service data for all the dates of core inland cover, so 1990 until 2018. Okay. So this was created with Web App Builder. So we'll have the possibility of downloading data in different formats, shapefiles and TIFFs. Okay. And the user will have access to data to navigate on the data, print, measure, etc. So the common usual tools in JS. Okay, so this is the looks of the WebJS. It's almost ready. So the idea is that we provide all this data for free, so people can start using it for whatever they want. Okay, with no restrictions. So these are the services we are providing: climate regulation, habitat quality. So this will have spatial resolution of Corian land cover. Okay, so this is calculated for Corian land cover, and these are the years of the calculations. This is an example of habitat quality for Portugal. This is about stakeholders' perception. Okay, so the WebGS will also have information about the concepts. Okay, of course, it will have more and more information. The idea is that people also get information about the concepts and the methodological aspects of the project. Okay, so these are more examples. We'll have some services, all the services, actually there are 8 services ready for downloads. Okay, of course we want to describe all these data sets so people understand well what they are working with. Okay, and now we finish. I still have some time, I hope, about half an hour. I know you should be tired by now, but the idea is that I show you that it's really easy to start calculating some indicators. And the indicator I've selected to show you here, it's available on this link. It's called Invest. Okay, let me see if I can share you my screen. So this link, so this software that I want to show is called Invest, which is here, the link, okay. So if you do a search by Natural Capital Project, get to their website, okay. And the software, hopefully you are all able to see what I'm doing in the browser. Okay. If not, please let me know. Okay. So we have the Invest software platform. You can check what they have here. Great to use. Okay. Okay. So you can download the software for free. This is an open model in the sense you can use it for free, but you also have access to the code in Python, so you can see the code and you can actually change the code to your own interest if you are a programmer. Okay, so it describes all the software here. You can download it. I already did. It's not very heavy. So you just need to click this link. Okay. And when downloading, you should also select to download the sample data sets. Okay. So I already installed this in my computer. I can download it again. Why not? Yeah, he's telling me I already downloaded this. Okay. So I'm going to hit next button. Of course, you agree with everything they ask at this phase when you're installing. Okay, so it's installing now. This is a very important option. So let's just select the carbon dataset. Otherwise, you'll be downloading hundreds of megabytes. Okay. So let's just select the carbon model. They have many models, I will show you. And the one we are going to use is the carbon model. So it takes not so much time to download, hopefully. Okay, might have questions. I still have about 25 minutes or so. I think it will be enough. You can try this on your own, of course. No problems. Finish and installation is complete. So nothing happened, don't worry. We cannot see anything. But here, if you scroll down the web page, you'll see which models are available. So there is a model for carbon, there is a model for crops, pollination, habitat quality. So they are improving this. I'm working with this model since 2012 or so. Okay, so, and every year or every couple of months, they upgrade the software and corrections, so things are getting better. Okay, so we are going to work with the carbon model. Okay, if you click carbon model, you have access to an explanation. You have access to the key references behind the development of this model, behind the development, and not behind the application of this model, because there are hundreds of papers that are using this software for calculating tons of carbon per hectare sequestration. Okay, so, okay, you also have access to the user guide, okay, which is very important. We tend not to look into the user guide sometimes. But here it explains the model itself, how it works, limitations and simplifications. You can also use scenarios for RED. So it's for people. So for those of you who know, it's reducing emissions from forest degradation. Okay. So limitations and simplifications, this is very important. This is a very simple model. Okay. Then you have very important data needs. What data do you need to run this model? Okay. So basically, I need a land cover map. Okay. So a land cover map can be for inland cover or for the Portuguese case, the CAOP, administrative map of Portugal. Okay. I'm sure for Spain, there is also national land cover that you can use. Okay. So I need land cover, and then I also need a CSV file, okay, with data about the carbon stored in four pools for each land cover class, okay? So basically I need a table with the land use codes to associate it to the land cover map, and then I need to have information for the carbon pools. So basically, a table like this one. Okay, so let's say if I have five classes, I need to have a land use code to match it with my land cover map. If it doesn't match, it will not calculate anything. Then for each land cover class, I have information for the four pools of carbon, okay, carbon above, carbon below in the soil, or carbon. That. Okay, so basically you just need to have this information. Of course, if you are working with 30 or 40 classes, like in Corinth land cover, you will need to have this information for each kind of land cover class. Okay. Okay, so let's run the carbon model. So when we install the invest, we need to access it through the start menu, okay? So you can start by writing invest. We will show you the names of the models, okay? Being the one that I want to open, the one which is called carbon, okay? So first, this is free software. Don't expect fancy interfaces like this is the case. So basically, it will open a window, okay, which has all the information that you need for filling with the right data sets. Okay, so you need to define where are you going to store the data. Okay, by default, you will use your user documents. Okay, so if you don't do anything different when installing the software and the data sets, you will use this by default, which is okay. Okay. Then you need a current land cover raster format. Okay. So here we need to get the data directly from the sample data folder. Okay. So we need a TIFF file, okay, which is, so if you follow the tutorial they have there, so we need to have a land cover map with the current land cover for a location called Willamette, okay? So let's open this, okay? Then I need carbon pools, okay? You have information specifying what you need for this input, okay? So a table that contains columns, LU, LC, C above. So basically, if you need to work with this, you need to replicate the data you have like this, okay? So where is this data? Let's see. Yeah, it's here. I'm going to open this folder. Here. So this is the carbon pool data, which is a CSV file. I'm going to open it. So in case you want to do this for inland cover, you need to replicate something like this. So I didn't open this correctly, but basically you have here, so it should be separated by columns, but it's not a problem. So basically we have the names of the fields on the top, then for each field you have land use code, you have the description of the class, and then you have the four pools. Okay, so basically this is the content of CSV, which you can put this as a table with a field for each column. Okay, so you can create this in Excel file or a Microsoft Access file. So you need to prepare this table for core inland cover if you want to use core inland cover. Okay. And of course, the land use code should match exactly the land use code you use, let's say, in core inland cover. Okay. So I'm going to close this Excel file. To say okay. So basically, this is all I need. So I need to define my workspace. I need to define my current land use land cover map, which is a TIFF. Okay, could be core inland cover. Okay. Then I also need to have a table where I have land use for each land use type. I have the four pools with values on it, okay? So basically what you need is to find the land cover map, which is easy, but then the most complicated thing is to create the carbon pools table. And we did that, for instance, for Portugal, for Corinne Cover, based on literature review. Okay. Actually, one of the papers we published, we also show the information we got for the carbon pools. Okay. Then there are more things we could calculate, like we could also run the valuation model. Okay. I'm not going to do that because in 1 hour we cannot do everything. So it's better to do this just the basic calculation. And then you can easily follow the tutorial and calculate carbon sequestration. For this, you need 2 dates. Okay. And then you can also calculate to run the valuation model, for which you just need to say the value of the carbon. There are several versions of the value of the carbon. Okay. So let's run this. Okay. Yeah, I already ran this before, so I'm going to overwrite what I did before. And the model was completed successfully. Okay. So where was this information stored? So the results would be, in my case, I have them here in another folder. I will just show you. So I'm just trying to locate. My working folder is, which should be, I'm going to open the workspace, it's here. I was forgetting about this simple detail. And he opens the corresponding folder with my results. Okay. Inside there, you have a log file. Okay. My last try. So the log file is very important, so you know what were the parameters you used for your model, so you can run it again if you want. You also have an HTML file, okay? The HTML file gives you the total carbon stored in that land cover area, okay? So in that case, it was for a location called Willamette. And most importantly, besides the total quantity of tons carbon, it also gives you a TIFF file, okay? With a map showing those results, okay? So this is a TIFF, it's a georeference TIFF. You can use quantum G's or ArcGIS, whatever, to check the results, okay? So, and I already put the data here. It's not an open software in this case, I'm sorry. I didn't have QGIS down in my computer, but this is just to show you what kind of results you're going to get. Basically, we have a TIFF file. You can see the red areas. So this will be the quantity of carbon per hectare, okay, in tons. Okay, so the red areas have lower quantity of carbon, green areas have higher quantity of carbon. You can see, I'm turning on and off. You can see that the urban areas, you have less carbon. And then when you go to the forest, you have more carbon. Okay. Okay. So as you can see, it's quite easy to do these calculations. So easily I can do an history of Portugal with Corinne Land Cover starting in 1990. Okay. That's how we did it for our research projects. Okay. And basically then you can monitor carbon sequestration over time. Okay. And then you have administrative areas. You can do calculations per district, per nuts 2, nuts 3, whatever, and see who is performing well or performing less well in terms of climate regulation impact. Okay, so we measure carbon as a proxy of climate regulation ecosystem service, and then you can see where the big problems are in the territory, and then we can take decisions to try to fix that situation. Okay, so as you can see, it's easy. It's not so easy if you don't have basic knowledge of GIS, okay? But I think you can calculate this easily if you want, okay? So this was the carbon model, but then you have other models here. This is the one of the most simplest models, okay? Let's see the other models to see, for instance, for that project about Portugal we are working on, we also used erosion regulation, okay, sediment retention, we used water purification, we used recreation, we used habitat quality, we used crop pollination, we used carbon, okay, and we could provide a picture of Portugal since the 90s, okay? And we are also now doing some economic valuation for some of those services, okay? So, as a concluding remark, my objective here was to show you it's very important to know about the ecosystem services concept because they are directly connected to our quality of life, okay? If you don't manage them, keep their production, preserve their production, your life quality of life will be affected, okay? So GIS is an incredible tool to work with ecosystem services because we are interested in knowing where they are, but GIS can also help you to do the calculations, okay? We can, for instance, connect erosion models to see erosion regulation, which is also an ecosystem service, okay? Okay, there are many, many other ways of calculating ecosystem services because there are many indicators we can use. The biggest challenge now is to calculate also in economic terms and above all, to integrate this kind of information into planning, into decision making, okay? If we just calculate things and we don't see them working in the territory as a practical measure of sustainability and management, well, these calculations are good as zero, okay? But what I wanted to show you here is that there is open data, there is open models, and anybody can work with this, okay? I used here, the only thing that I didn't use, which is not open, was ArcGIS, but just to show you the result of the model, but I could see this also in QGIS without any problem. Okay, so that's all I had to tell you. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'll be happy to answer any question you may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Pedro.
Thank you.
Are there any questions?
Any questions?
Pues no parece, Pedro, que haya cuestiones, pero una gran atención, muchos participantes.
Okay. Thank you very much. I hope you share the video. And if you have any questions, you have my email. Feel free to contact me. I'm always interested in collaboration in this kind of topic. Okay.
Okay.
So I will stop sharing. Okay. Okay, so if you don't have any questions, shall we stop the session here?
Mira, hay una pregunta en el chat, ¿te acuerdas?
Okay, in the chat.
De Sofía.
Okay, Sofia. Hello, Sofia. So, what is the spatial resolution of the results? Well, it's like in JS, it depends on the input data, okay? And then the output data, you can tell the JS the resolution you want. But of course, it cannot be higher or better than the input data, okay? So in this case, we are reporting all the results using Corinland Cover. So we are providing results at pixel level of 100 meters, okay? So I'll put just here my email in case you didn't get it. So it's in the chat, so feel free to send me email. Okay, thank you. Okay, there are many studies about ecosystem services for small regions, and sometimes also for country level. Okay, so in this project we are doing, the challenge was to provide information at national level. Okay, but having Corinland cover, you can do this for all Europe if you want. Okay. But of course, for taking decisions, then you will need more more resolution, more detailed information. This will only give you a picture at Corin level resolution. Okay, so cannot have more information than the one provided by Corin resolution.
Pues muchas gracias, Pedro. Muchas gracias a todos.
Okay.
Pues entonces vamos a por la sesión. Nada, os esperamos mañana. Mañana más presentaciones y más talleres.
Okay.
Pedro, por favor, envíame si puedes la presentación por correo,
sí.
¿vale?
Vou fazer isso.
Muchísimas gracias.
Já. Ok, muito obrigado.
Muito obrigada.
Boa tarde e graças.